Praise the Lord, everybody. God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Psalm 100 says, to make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before God's presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is God that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are God's people, and the sheep of his pasture. The word says to enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto God, and bless God's name. For the Lord is good, church. Anybody know that today? God is good all the time. The Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. At this time, would you bow with me for our opening prayer? Gracious, holy, just, forgiving, inclusive God, we thank you for this day. Thank you, God, for this time. Thank you, God, for this Sunday, which we will never see again. God, we thank you for your grace on today. We thank you for your love and your mercy and your power divine. God, we ask that you would continue to move by your spirit in this place. Continue to move by your spirit in each and every one of us. Continue to move by your spirit throughout the globe. God, we ask that you would hear the prayers of your people. We know the prayers of the righteous availeth much. And we know, God, that you're a God that can do anything but fail. And we know that you always are doing things that's going to work out for our good. And so, God, we ask that you would come in right now. Come into this house of worship. We ask, oh God, that you would have your way in this place. We ask, oh God, that you would shower down blessings upon your people. We ask, oh God, that those who are on their way, you would give them traveling grace and traveling mercy. We ask, oh God, that you would transform us, oh God. Transform us so that we might not go out the same way that we came in. God, we just confess today that we love you, we honor you, we reverence you, we adore you, and we lift your name high. God, we ask that the wrestling that is going on with the people all across the globe, that you would step in, oh God, and lead them and guide them in the right direction. We ask, oh God, that you would bring peace and harmony in our country. We ask that you would allow the people to be on one accord and of one mind. We ask, oh God, that justice might prevail in this country and all across the world. God, bless this worship, oh God. Bless every worshiper, oh God. Bless those who have taken time out to come on today to be able to call upon your holy name and just sit in your presence and bask in your glory. God, we thank you. Thank you for another opportunity to gather with the saints in your house of worship once again. God, this is our prayer. We lift to you in Jesus' holy name, we do pray. Let all the people of God say amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Liberation Cathedral, better known as ELC. We are an affirming church. We are an inclusive church. We are a church that celebrates all of God's people. And so we want you to know that God loves you here and that God affirms you here. And we want you to feel the power and presence of God every time you walk through these doors. And so we also like to tell you to keep out your cell phones, keep out your iPads, keep out your tablets. If God speaks anything to you, we want you to tweet it out. We want you to post it out. We want you to put it on Instagram, put it on Snapchat. Let the world know what you have experienced in this place, in this worship. Now, we always want you to share your joy. You might not have had a chance to greet someone. You might not have had a chance to say hello. And somebody might need to feel the love of Christ through you. Somebody might need for you to offer them what you have on today. And you might need to receive what somebody else has. And so find three people. Let them know God is good all the time. Somebody just needs to know God is good on today.
Because
provider. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Truly, that is a powerful, powerful song. And we thank God for Deacon Catherine and the praise team on today. I believe after looking at the march on yesterday and after looking at so many feet that I needed to look at what was going on in the country and possibly parallel some message with that. And so I changed the message, and the message that I believe is the word for today is a confrontation with Jesus. So if you will turn with me to Mark chapter 5, Mark chapter 5. And if you'll stand for the reading of the gospel, Mark chapter 5, beginning at verse 6. Well, no, I'm going to go back to verse 2 and read a couple of those verses and then 6 through 8. The word of the Lord says, "And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs. And no man could bind him, no, not with chains. But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him, and cried with a loud voice, and said, What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. For he said unto him, Come out of the man, thou unclean spirit." So once again, I want to tag this particular text by simply calling it a confrontation with Jesus. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Here we are in our text today where Jesus has just demonstrated to the disciples the power that he has over the wind and the waves, while at the same time pointing out to them their lack of faith. Sometimes you got to be confronted about the things that you do or the lack of things that you are doing. I was glad to see on Saturday the women marching to confront Donald Trump about his views, about his leadership, and his treatment of women in America. Women all over the world, church, came out and marched in solidarity to publicly confront the horrible ideologies of this new president. And church, sometimes confrontation is the only way to get things back on track and moving in the right direction. What if Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. had said, "I don't want to have any confrontations"? Where would we be with our civil rights on today? What if Rosa Parks had said, "I don't want to have any confrontations"? Where would we be with equal rights with transportation on today? What if J.F. Kennedy, Bobby Kennedy, or even Teddy Kennedy had said they didn't want any confrontations? Where would we be with rights for all races, rights for disabled persons, rights for children, and even access to health care? What if the person that brought you to Christ had said they did not want any confrontations? Would you be saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost on today? No, you might have been locked up and behind bars. You might have been in the crazy house or a mental institution. You might have even been dead, sleeping in your grave. You might have aborted your purpose and never walked in your destiny. But because somebody was willing to confront what was going on in your life and tell the devil openly that he could not have you, look at where you are on today. Look at what the Lord has done in your life, church. Look at how blessed you are because of a confrontation with the Lord himself or with one of God's servants. Sometimes I came to tell you there must be confrontation in order to bring about change. Sometimes there must be confrontation in order to bring about justice. Sometimes there must be confrontation in order to gain freedom for the people. Sometimes there must be confrontation in order to bring about salvation in the lives of people who need it most. And as God's people, we cannot be afraid of confrontation that will bring about change on today. There is confrontation that must occur in the life of every believer. And just as there are some things we must confront in the natural church, there are some things we must confront in the spiritual as well. When you get ready to confront some things in the spiritual, now I came to tell you, you can't be a chump. You gotta be strong. You gotta be confident. You gotta walk in assurance. You gotta stand in holy boldness, knowing that God and Jesus have got your back. But the thing I like about confrontation, church, is that there must always be some result. If we go in trying to do confrontation on our own without Jesus Christ, the result may not be what we want it or need it to be. If we go in without Jesus, we may end up in fatality and injury. If we go in without Jesus, we may end up laid out on the ground. If we go in without Jesus, we may end up somewhere we never planned or desired to be. But if we have Jesus on our side, the result is something that is sure to change our lives for our good. So the question becomes, church, what is it that you've been needing to confront in your own life? Will you miss out on all that God has for you because of your fear to be in confrontation? Isn't it funny how we can deal with everybody else's stuff but can't deal with our own? Isn't it funny how we can be health experts for others, financial managers for others, love and relationship experts for others, career experts for others, but can't do any of that for ourselves? It is very easy, church, to work on other folk, but the real challenge comes when we have to work on ourselves. Many times we are in denial that we even need help. We don't want to even abide by the advice we give to others when it so clearly applies to us too. The bad thing about when the enemy takes over now is that he often has your mind so clouded that you are not yourself. The Bible says the man would cut himself with stones. Now, who in their right mind cuts themselves with a stone? It's quite clear here that this man was not in his right mind and was possessed by some kinds of spirits. When spirits are instructing you, it becomes obvious to those who are around you who can see what you often cannot, that you need some help and you need to get some help soon. The devil, church, will have your mind and cause you to do things that make people wonder, have you lost the good sense that God gave you? Sometimes it causes us, when we are dealing with these spirits, it causes us to take risks with persons who we know are not faithful and could thus pass on serious diseases to us that we may not be able to get rid of. And we do it because of how they look. I might not be talking to everybody. We do it because of the things that they say to us. We do it because of how much they throw our way. We do it because of the money, like you say, they put in our pockets. We do it because of the way they make us feel. Sometimes it causes us to even give others our credit cards, knowing we just met them. Now, sometimes it causes us to pay all of their bills. I'm talking to the lights. I know I ain't talking to none of y'all. Knowing we don't really know anything about them. Sometimes it will cause us to lay out the red carpet and take them across the world on a trip that they could not afford, and you really could not either, because when you return, you don't know if you have a way to live or even a way to eat. But the enemy will have your mind, and it will affect your mind in such a way that it will cause you to almost lose it if you don't deal with what is happening in your life. And so we got to begin to have the confrontation with God and recognize that things that are happening are simply a trick of the enemy, and you need to call him out as soon as you can. But the celebration I see in all of this is that when the Lord has an ordained purpose and plan for your life, it doesn't matter how crazy or how much crazy stuff you find yourself doing. Doesn't matter how much stuff happens in your life that almost kills you or almost takes you out. It doesn't matter how many things you get entangled in that hurts your body or hurts your heart. It doesn't matter how crazy the situations are that you keep finding yourself in. Sooner than later, Jesus is going to step on the scene of your life. Let the devil know that it is coming to a halt. He's got to let you go in the name of Jesus. Church, you got to remember that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. So church, Jesus will show up. I thank God that he'll show up and all things will come to a halt just because he's now on the scene of your life. Have you ever noticed how when there are persons doing bad things, when someone comes around who's filled with the Spirit of God, they can stop doing that long enough that the person who is there will not be exposed to what they are doing or be disrespected by what is taking place in that place in their presence. And so I came to tell somebody, there is something about Jesus Christ that commands respect whenever he shows up on the scene. There is something about Jesus Christ that says that no evil shall be able to prevail in my presence. There is something about Jesus Christ, church, that says that everything must come to a halt when I arrive on the seed of this circumstance. And you ought to be glad today that Jesus is the one covering you. You ought to be glad today that Jesus is the name that you call on. You ought to be glad today that Jesus' blood is the blood that's covering you all today. So I came to tell somebody, step up to the plate. Be willing to confront that which may be standing in between you and your destiny. The text tells us that the man who was full of demons ran to Jesus and worshiped him. So that lets you know that deep down on the inside, you can have a whole lot of stuff going on in your life. Probably most of it don't have nothing to do with honoring God. But somewhere deep down in the innermost chambers of your very being, underneath all that stuff that is layering what's going on with you, there is a spirit man and a spirit woman, and your spirit man is crying out to the Lord underneath all of that stuff. Your spirit man is tired of all that's been happening in your life. Your spirit man is tired of how these things have been controlling you and really has you out of control. Your spirit man is growing weary and has been calling out to the holy name of God because it knows where your help is going to come from. Your spirit knows if it can get you close enough to Jesus, if it can push you into his presence, it knows that everything will be all right after a while. Might I propose to you on today that your spirit man knows and fully understands, even though you may not, your spirit man understands the crisis that you are in. Your spirit man knows how critical it is for you to get in the presence of the Lord, because this may be your last chance. That's why I believe that we are people of God, or we as a people of God sometimes arrive at a point which I like to call a crisis of conscience, where we have to look at our lives and we got to make some hard decisions. The Bible says when the man saw Jesus from afar off, he wasn't even close to him, but he saw him in the distance and he ran and worshiped him. His crisis of conscience led him to make the decision to get before Jesus as quickly as he could and surrender his all. You see, deep down on the inside, away from the demons now, was his spirit man who knew that he was in crisis. And if he could just get him there, the spirit was pushing him. The spirit recognized the Savior from afar off. He knew that if he could get him there, he would be all right. Have you ever noticed, church, sometimes when you feel like if you could just make it to to the church house on Sunday, everything would be all right. Anybody ever felt that way? You feel if you could just make it to the altar for the service, that everything would be all right. If you could just come in where the presence of the Lord is and sing the songs of Zion, everything would be all right. I believe that that's a crisis of consciousness that you are in. That's because your spirit man knows the urgency that is going on in your life. Your spirit man knows how critical you really are. And if he doesn't push you towards the Savior, you might not make it. If the spirit man doesn't push you towards the Savior, your time here on earth might be cut short. If the spirit man doesn't push you towards the Savior, you might not ever realize your destiny. So it's my belief, church, that here in this particular text, the running symbolizes a decision that was made in the midst of being in a crisis of consciousness and in realizing the sense of urgency to save his life. Truly, if you think about it, there was a sense of urgency there. There was a sense of criticalness. There was a sense of pressure, a sense of seriousness, a sense of life and death. A sense of nowness is what I want to call it. That it was now or never. Truth of the matter is, some of us are in now or never situations. Some of our friends are in now or never situations. Some of our family members are in now or never situations. In those situations, it's my hope that we will realize that we serve a God who can do anything but fail. Amen. I hope that we will realize that God says, no weapon formed against you shall be able to prosper. I hope that we will realize that we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. I hope that we realize that greater is he that is within me than he that is in the world. I thank God, church, for spiritual confrontations that occur in my life. Because when I make the right decisions, I'll become brand new. When I make the right decisions, I'll have joy like I did not have before. When I make the right decisions, I will have direction like I did not have before. When I make the right decision, I'll have peace like I did not know before. When I make the right decision, I'll have new power, new life, and new assignments like I did not know before. The confrontation is what some of us need on today. Get this, church. The celebration here in this story is that the 2,000 demons that were possessing this man at the permission of Jesus went out and entered into swine and left the man clothed in his right mind. That's a reason to celebrate right there. The point here is that when confronted with Jesus, I came to tell you the devil will never win. When going against the Savior, evil will never prevail. When challenging the master, the demons will always be slaughtered. So if you're looking for some things to change in your life, you need to have your situation confronted by Jesus Christ, our Lord. And after the confrontation, I declare that you'll have peace like never before. I declare that you'll have power like never before. I declare you'll have strength like never before. You just gotta trust the process and trust the Savior that everything's gonna work out for your good. Anybody needs some things to work out? Six. church. If you let go and let God on today. It will work out, church. If you keep the word in your heart and in your spirit. It will work out, church. If you love the Lord and serve Him till you die. I know about you today, church, but I want the Lord to work some things out. Anybody need God to work some things out? Work some things out for my good. Work on my heart, Lord, so that will change your life for good. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this offering that was given, God. God, thank you for these many gifts that was given on today, God. God, we ask you to bless it. Bless those who were able to give, those who were not able to give, God, that when they come back into the storehouse, they will be able to pour into this ministry. God, those who will be able to give, God, may you continue to bless them and keep them, God. Bless all of your dear people that's here today. God, we ask you to let this offering be used for the upkeeping of your kingdom, God, and for the rebuild of the kingdom, God. God, we ask you to continue to multiply, continue to open up a window and pour our blessing to those who felt it was not robbery to give unto this ministry, unto this house, your storehouse, God. God, we just thank you for keeping us all again for another Sunday and bringing us here to worship one another. God, those who are absent, God, from the church, God, continue to keep them and stir up their hearts. God, they will be here next Sunday to be able to do what thus says the Lord. God, we love you. We thank you for always being our friend and our provider. Continue to bless this offering. And let it be used for your purpose, only. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You are
somebody say, greater is here. I'm here with the deacons of Empowerment Liberation Cathedral. We want to invite you to worship with us each and every Sunday here in Silver Spring at 1 p.m. We are located at 633 Sligo Avenue, Silver Spring, Maryland. This is the Medical